Welcome back. Game number two, Alotum versus MVP Phoenix. Coming up next, we have, first of all, I just want to take a moment. After this best of three, we are going to be trying to jump straight into the next match, which is going to be Ray versus Pokerface. Actually looking forward to that one because it should be a pretty even matchup, I would say. But we're going to be trying to start that one right away. But if not, if the teams aren't ready, we're going to be starting that at 14 CEST. So we may be having a bit of a break. And then once we finish up that, we'll have another break, and then we get into the ISO Cup, which is going to be having teams, a lot of great teams, in the in this first rendition of the ISO Cup. First time we've had an ISO Cup in quite some time. In fact, before I was a part of Join Dota, pretty much, was the last time that we had had an ISO Cup, and it's actually a lot of really good teams. Team Tinker is going to be facing up against Hellraisers. Hellraisers have been doing pretty damn good lately, so they should be able to put up a good fight and their best of one. And then on the other side of the bracket, we have the four anchors plus one sea captain, which is Trixie's Finstack, going up against Denial. Denial, of course, being Bucking Mad's new team. So that's the Dota for the day. We have the semifinals as well as the best of three finals that are going to be happening. So be sure to tune in for that. In the meantime, though, we have MVP Phoenix versus Lodum, a draft that is pretty interesting. MVP Phoenix have been doing a lot of good things with this Warlock, and they managed to get it into their hands alongside the Doom as well as now the Disruptor. While Lodum have picked up both a Razor, Shadow Shaman, and now a Viper. Is there a third pickup? I would love to see a Shatter Demon, honestly. Let's go Aghanim Shatter Demon. That's one hell of a way to counter the Warlock. I doubt we're going to be seeing Shatter Demon, but still, a Defusal Hero is always nice to have when you're facing up against a Warlock like this one. The Omni-Knight, I also love the bans, the Omni-Knight and the Slark being banned away by Lodum. MVP Phoenix have been running that one, both of those heroes, with a good deal of success. And then their last ban on the side of MVP Phoenix. Well, the Centaur as well as the Tidehunter ban away both of the strong offlane initiators. Both the heroes that are able to jump on the Warlock. Warlock needs some room to be able to work, and that's why they ban away two of those offlane initiators.
Riki.
Vernet, whoa! All right!
Dire team pick.
The new Riki. I'm looking forward to this. I'm looking forward to this quite a bit. The new Rikimaru, new and improved, starting out with level 1 invisibility. There have been some considerations talking about whether or not Rikimaru is actually a viable hero now, and whether he is a viable offlaner or
five
what.
5 seconds remaining.
But this should be pretty interesting. New invisibility actually having a very, very long delay time, but actually gives you a lot of HP regen. And that regen only goes away if you yourself take out your invisibility. So if you're silenced or if you attack somebody, you will lose your regeneration. Otherwise, if you're revealed by any dust or anything, technically you're still in an invisible state, even if you can be seen, and you hold on to your regen. Which makes me wonder whether this hero is a viable offlaner or not.
MVP Phoenix's
and how viable he is with his new ultimate, the Blink Strike, which now holds charges that restore every 30 seconds. But these charges, I'm not sure if 30 seconds is enough time or how this is going to work. I haven't really seen it in action just yet. But able to basically lay in a burst amount of damage.
Dire team
Skywrath Mage. Going to be the last ban here by MVP Phoenix. One of the stronger nukers, silencers. Makes a lot of sense up against the Riki. While Lodum, their fourth pickup was a Lifestealer.
10 seconds.
Relatively tanky hero, but very susceptible to the smokescreen from the Rikimaru. So I'm a little bit surprised we're going to be seeing that one. And now our last ban from Lodum is going to be banning away that Jakiro, knowing that MVP Phoenix, they would love to be able to run some additional pushing power. And there's no support left in the pool that gives them the same kind of pushing power as the Jakiro does. Undying does add in a lot of aggression, which can transition into taking down towers. So it's it's going to be an interesting game, that's for sure. The Warlock, I can't wait till we see the possibility of the upheaval combined with the Tombstone. That's going to be a rough combination.
5 seconds.
We also have the possibility of the Smokescreen over the Tombstone as well, making it harder for you to be able to kill the Tombstone. There's many different possibilities. So the Venomancer being our last pickup here for Ludum is a pretty crappy support. There is no other way around it. I do not like the Venomancer support. I think he is really, really poor. I love the Venomancer core, hate the Venomancer support. And I thought we were going to see some buffs to Venomancer support in 6.82, but the only buff that they received was the ultimate, which I would say is more of a buff to the core Venomancer than anything else. So
10 seconds.
I can't stand Venomancer. I completely disagree with this pickup. I think they had many other support options that would have been just as viable, if not much more so. But we'll see how it managed to make it work. They are going to be running some sort of
prepare for battle
duo or aggro lane, I believe. Or not. I guess a defensive tri lane for them. They're just going to leave the Lifestealer as the solo off lane. Once again. Going an aggro try up against an Undying is probably a really bad idea. So they'd actually picked up some sort of really defensive support. They could have ran dual lanes, potentially. But that's not going to be happening here. Sunbee already making his way in. Lays down her early ward, but will be spotted out by March. And the ward quick to be countered, I'm sure. They're going to be running a defensive tri lane with the Rikimaru in lane, a mid Warlock, and an off lane Doom on the side of MVP.
30 seconds to battle.
Look at the mass boots. That's something that has always stood out to me in Korean Dota. The mass boots that ends up being picked up by the team. We have boots on Warlock, boots on the Undying as well. Even though the boots on Warlock, I really agree with. Because you don't want to be going up again. You know your matchup is 1v1 up against the Razor. And you do not want to be at a movement speed disadvantage.
Death's bounty.
Well, that's a great start. He actually finds himself a regen rune. So despite the fact that he took like 150, 200 damage there, he's still going to be back up to full. And it looks like MVP are going to be running the aggro try. Or at least some sort of dual lane. Yeah, looks like dual lanes. Reason's going to be trying to push back the Razor here in the first couple of levels. Don't know if he actually stays here or not, but maybe just trying to... I thought with the boots first, maybe March would have enough to be able to deal with the Razor. But apparently they want that extra bit of control. Smoke up, and it looks like Venomancer and Shadow Shaman will be rotating to the bottom lane where they don't want to be fighting up against the Undying Doom combination. And really, there's no sense. They can leave the Viper alone in lane. They have no need of protecting this guy. It's pretty unlikely, unless he gets caught out by later on in the levels when he gets can be caught out by the Glimpse plus Kinetic Field. Then yeah, sure. But until then, the Viper is going to be quite strong up against their very passive tri lane. And now, QO. He's in some serious trouble here. He has no invisibility, but not like it would matter anyway. They already have the counter wards ready to go. And they take him down. How the hell can you see me? Well, you don't even have invisibility leveled, for starters. Just for starters. And I wonder with this new Riki, what if you go for a 114 build still? Or do you put more levels in that invisibility for the faster fade time plus that amazing HP regen? I mean, you go up to 7 health regen a second at level 7 if you max it out. That's pretty insane. That's a lot of survivability. Corpses. I guess it depends on how active you are for farming and how active you're going to be spending time looking for those ganks around the map. If you're just spending time in a more static lane looking to farm up, I would say the invis probably preferable.
I deserve this.
But if you're a bit more active, you may require the damage from your backstab. Another smoke gank from the side of Lottom. This time around, it's going to be Aang for picking off March, who will be now stunned up. Yo-Jung needs to come back and get enough right clicks in. It looks like the Venomancer is actually going to be the one getting that last hit. The Shadow Shaman will be going down in return, though, from Ryzen. It's still worth it for Lottom as they, they did a lot there. Unfortunately, the Razor lost a lot of HP in the process. So when the Warlock actually comes back, he's going to have a pretty big advantage over this Razor. At least until the Courier comes in with the bottle. Kind of needs to be upgraded. Nimble Ben. Fly, Nimble Ben, fly. Top lane for Rev is going to be having a rough go with this Viper. In fact, he'll probably be losing his life here. As with no Scorched Earth, he's pretty damn squishy. And so easily kited around by that Viper. So the roaming supports from the side of Lottom doing a lot of work so far in this game. I won't say it's because of the Venomancer's support. That's for sure, but he's doing a lot of work for them. But I think he just as easily could be replaced by any other support. Phase boots soon for the Warlock, and I'm going to put soon in quotations here because he may be picked off. Sunbeat trying to get close enough for the level 1 open wounds. Does finally get it. March starts healing himself up, but he's not making it out of here. Especially with the vision granted by that that static link. Ryzen does not have enough mana for a glimpse, so I'm not sure what he thinks he's doing. But whatever the plan is, it's not going to work.
Regeneration.
Dubu, well, he got a little bit of regen on his mana back. Heen really needs some levels. He is 5 minutes in level 1. That's not the way to play undying. Like, you gotta be like level 5 before you're really useful as an undying. Like, before you're a good harasser and everything else, but Tombstone, you can't really get a whole lot of kill potential out of level 1 and even level 2 Tombstone. You need level 3. And you'd also like to either have a second level in Decay or my preference, which is a level in Soul Rift. Tombstone goes down, but it's really just going to add extra gold, I think, to the side of Lottom. Yep, an extra 75 gold. Pretty useless. I mean, you got to be careful with that Tombstone. Undying is not a hero that needs to be falling behind. So he needs to spend some good amount of time farming up the lane. Less roaming, more farming. How's our bottom lane doing? It is QO versus Sunbee's Lifestealer, who is currently having a hard time dealing with the smoke screen. And there you see the first Bling Strike in action. It'd be a pretty favorable lane for the Riki. Oh, jump in, smoke screen, and another jump. Pretty useful Bling Strike for popping these support heroes real quickly. I'm still a bit concerned that 30 seconds is maybe a bit too long recovery time for the Rikimaru and his Blink Strikes. I think that's really going to limit how active he can be. Like, it's nice to be able to get multiple blink strikes in the space of, like, 5 seconds. But it really sucks that you just can't go for another kill like that 30 seconds later, because then you'll only have one blink strike up. Phase boost for the Warlock. He's still having a hard time in this mid lane matchup, though. He's ahead of the Razor, but there have been a lot of kills back and forth. Jump in, Sunbee. Okay. Could have popped the Rage there if they really wanted to go for that kill. And I think they could have. Ferev didn't have Scorched Earth at the time. He's going to wrap around behind him, though. Ferev should be dying here. As well, they actually don't have an additional slow from Ian, but maybe the right click damage is enough. Scorched Earth, just enough regen to keep him alive. Ferev will be forced back. And unfortunately, Ian, if he had an additional slow there, it's all because they didn't rage up and go for the kill properly last time. Undying now going to pop his Tombstone. Venomancer is going to be caught by that one. And just one zombie is all it takes. Zombaman gets a kill and is now level 4, so making some recovery. He actually went for the level 2 of Decay. I prefer Soul Rip. I think Soul Rip is a vastly underrated ability. It's 125 damage, nuke or heal. Pretty much guaranteed, because how often are you in a situation where there aren't 5 units around you? Whether it's enemies or allies or anything. Neutrals, like, there's so many different things. In fact, I even like to be able to get a level 2 Soul Rip. I think level 2 Soul Rip is the most efficient, just because in lane, you're oftentimes going to have about 8 to 10 units in the fields, easily accessible. Warlock Golem going to be dropped on Yojung here, and it looks like that should be a free kill. So QO in his first rotation. Interesting item build here. He went for the early lifesteal. Not really what I was expecting. Is he going Mask of Madness, or is he going Vlad's? Or Helm of Dominator? Honestly, I don't like Helm of Dominator. Mask of Madness is a maybe, I guess. I don't think it's necessary in Ariki, but the mass attack speed could be good. And Vladimir is, I can't really get behind either. Dying Tombstone won't put a stop to this push here in the top lane, where the tier 1 tower will end up falling. Glimpse back though, Shatter Shaman. Gonna be put in the Static Storm, the right side. March tried to come in, but is immediately gonna be targeted by the Viper following. Dubu, unable to get the kill on Reesin, maybe losing his life's last hit from the Disruptor will do the trick. March, meanwhile, will be going down. Doom being placed on Yojung as the Doom comes in from behind. They're going to turn around and focus on QO, though, who is very, very tanky. And is now making his distance away. The Mask Madness, Heen is not going to be as lucky as he's slowed down by the open wounds. And that wasn't a terrible fight for MVP. Slow solely because of the fact that QO was able to get out. But definitely needs to be a lot more careful next time. Overall, though, Ludum was able to take a win out of that team fight. 1,000 gold plus another 2,000 experience. Namely, most of that money being on the two cores, which is on the side of Ludum, which is pretty rough. Shadow Shaman now with the Mask of Madness. Apparently, QO feeling pretty manly. The Static Link goes out, and he'll back himself up. Maybe go back in with the smoke screen. I don't know. Razor's pretty tanky. I'm not sure if this is a fight they can quite take. The burnout, maybe with the Doom coming in from behind. The Viper's going to be able to give the mech heal. And now for Rev, mistakes were made, I think. Static Storm goes down. Now the Cloud at the same time. There goes the Venomancer Ultimate. And with the Mask of Madness, he'll be able to clean up two different heroes. And will probably be losing his life, but maybe not. He just wiped through all three of them. Now we'll die to the Venomancer Ultimate, which... with the poison of the ward, was able to get the kill. And a lot of gold for that Venomancer to be a part of that kill, but still, Riki playing havoc there. Looks like he's going to be going for a basher first build on the Riki. Pretty interesting idea. I think I like the general idea of it. I mean, it's a pretty greedy build, but really makes use of these early blink strikes. The extra power that you now receive, the extra bit of burst damage that you're able to throw in. I mean, you just look at that. That's 280 extra damage from these, just the blink strikes themselves. But then you combine the fact that every single blink strike is also a backstab hit. It's a pretty significant amount of burst damage.
Untraceable venom.
Golems are ready. Marge is going to be stunned up here. Gets off the golems, though, just in time. Now the turnaround silence. And I fear that both of these heroes may be going down. The Infest, not going to do much for Sunbeam. Going to be brought back into the tower and taken down by the golem. Double kill there for Marge.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
That was very, very greedy by them. Especially with without trying to initiate with the Hex first on the Shadow Shaman. Probably the worst idea of all. Jump in, immediately gets poisoned, but it seems like QO just simply does not care. Maybe he will. He's going to lose his life to the poison. Able to do a lot of damage in the meantime, though. Marge comes in and does have a fatal bond between the two of these heroes. Adam's going to die. Ian trying to go in for the deny, almost getting it there, but not quite. And Reason now looking for another glimpse. Is going to be able to send it back here. It's not going to go very far, though. And in fact, Reason needs to run himself away. Maybe with the phase boots plus the ward, slowing him down every tick. Next ward won't be able to land, unfortunately, and it looks like he is away. Sunbee, though, wants to continue to move forward. March is sitting pretty low here in this middle lane, though. He's currently healing up. Chasing in. Open wounds plus the slow. They might be able to get this kill, but the Riki is on his way, and that's a guy you do not want to be facing up, Ian. Pops his ultimate immediately. QL continues to move forward and wants to make as many kills as possible during this time, but will be forced back. Heen, meanwhile, dropped the tombstone, but that's not going to be enough to get any one kill. Ferev, meanwhile, did pick up the Shadow Shaman. Heen, I'm not sure why he came back forward like that. Got off a decay charge that gave him a lot of HP, but he lost even more thanks to the return fire of Laudum and his crew. And now they'll push into the middle tier 1 tower, and we'll take it with ease.
Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
I think QL being a bit too manly on his Riki so far. Not a whole lot of finesse. Seems like more of just constant man-moding. It's another great thing about the new Blink Strike. Blinking in, blinking out, guaranteed. Like, if you have two charges, it means you also have an escape. If you blink in, decide it's a bad idea, or even just able to pop one here really quickly and blink back out, you're not waiting on a cooldown. You can do it nigh instantly.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
And it seems like he, maybe 30 seconds is enough. He seems to be holding on to his charges pretty well. No, I have yet to see him use all four in one team fight.
Dire's top tower.
In which case, he would be
attack.
On cooldown for
Radiant's
kind of for 2 minutes straight.
Radiant structures are fortified. Dire's top
Basher is finished
tower.
Up by the Riki, though, and he's he's here, but he doesn't have his Basher. The silence onto Sunbee. This is a pretty good situation for them. Tombstone goes out, and they're going to focus on QL. Managed to make himself a jump away. Still going to die to the poison. Golem going down with the Tombstone. This is going to be a disaster here for Laudum, I think. As Heen, able to clean up another one in the background. Looks like he may be dying to the Viper. Reason almost dying there, but the Golems will be able to force back to Yojun. The only reason he's really alive right now is due to the Eye of the Storm. Blink away there from Reason. Nicely play. Adam, meanwhile, still pretty healthy. And the combination of the wards, good wards being dropped, the haste rune for the Razor, plus the Eye of the Storm killing the zombies, You guys didn't know, Eye of the Storm actually focuses in on the lowest HP unit. And that's zombies. When zombies spawn, they get zapped. So Yojung's Eye of the Storm is actually a really efficient way for them to be able to clear through those zombies to make sure they didn't get a gigantic stack on any one person. But yeah, that felt like that could have been so much more of a disaster. I think like it would have been a more disaster, but March has no levels up of evil. Which we've seen the way the Western scene has been playing around with this Warlock, and it's been all about the upheaval. Whether core or support, it's only been one or two levels in Fatal Bonds, if that. Oftentimes, it'll be a 044 build.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Refresher for Warlock. Doom actually going to be placed down on the Viper. Send back. Silence on a Sunbeam. Very nicely played. Looks like they're just going to use this time to finish off the Viper. Bash. And we'll be able to get it. QO needs some distance, though, to get away from this Static Link. The Send back Glimpse will actually do the trick. Now Tombstone comes out. Pretty good position for it. Forev will lose his life to Sunbeam. Immediately infest inside a creep. QO, though, has come back into the team fight. We'll be able to focus down the Venomancer. And now it's going to be the Tombstone up next. They can still see QO. Don't think he realized that one. As he had the dust on him, now just barely runs out of time. And the dust sent back, they can see him. They've got a counter ward ready to go. Oh, clipping him with the Mask of Madness on. The Riki does end up dying. QO, once again, playing it too manly. And will die again on this Riki Maru. Feel like he should be so much farther ahead, but he just keeps on dying over and over again. So he's not actually gaining that much. I mean, he's second in net worth. So he's obviously doing really well. I just feel like maybe he could be doing a bit better if he just controlled his aggression a bit better.
Mine.
Phase Boots Drums, 23 minutes in. We've, 23 to 15, 19 minutes in. Jeez, I'm getting my numbers all backwards. 7,500 gold lead right now and about a 6,000 experience lead for the side of MVP. They're doing a pretty good job controlling this game, though they don't have the same fear from last game, which was a lot of them had some really good late game on their team. Here, MVP actually have better late game between the Riki and the Doom. Say the Riki actually is potentially a better carry than he used to be. In fact, I would say actually 100% he's a better carry than he used to be. Blink strike opportunities. No, it just makes the hero a lot more versatile, I would say. And you can see the power of this Mask of Madness Riki. Ripping through another one. So he, I'm surprised he doesn't have more mana issues. Is Blink Strike, that many Blink Strikes plus the Cloud. Golems as well as the Tombstone gonna be dropped here on the Viper, who's immediately gonna get doomed up, and the Razor gets sent back to the top lane. They're gonna try and get what kills they can. Recent laying in extra bits of damage on Adam. Should be enough to tick him out here as the Doom will finish him off. And meanwhile, Sunbeam actually running himself into the side here, pops his Rage, and will be able to teleport out just in time. So they get two out of that one, the Shadow Shaman as well as the Viper, take down the Tier 1 tower, and should be able to take down the Tier 2 as well. Razor, meanwhile, needs to be able to just split push. I mean, he got destroyed pretty hard by that Glimpse send back. And now they could be destroyed even further. QL is going to be hit by the extra bits of poison, but This team should be able to keep him alive unless Shadow Shaman, who's able to pop a dust, immediately dies. Sunbee continuing to try and go for the Riki, but ends up getting blocked out by the kinetic field. And now he's in some serious trouble. Couldn't infest, was halfway through the animation there. The jump inside that range creep and could not make it. Back up to the top lane, Razor will be able to kill the Warlock there. And now we'll teleport back to base. Desperately needed that BKB though, cannot afford to be countered by that disruptor any further. Keen should be a mech for him. They don't have a mech hero, actually. Normally, you would look for the Doom to pick up the mech for the team, but he opts instead to go straight for Midas, Vlad's, and now a Shiva's. And he almost has the Shiva's. In fact, it's flying out to him right now. And okay, I mean, I figured there's Crimson Guard is pretty good for the Undying. Illusion. And I figured it's a possibility that he goes for a Crimson Guard, but when you don't have a mech on your team, I think mech is more essential. I mean, the damage block is nice, but mech is, I think, just essential for your team. So I'm a bit surprised he is going for that Crimson Guard, even though it is good for the Undying in general. Roshan. It's getting pretty low here. MVP need to be able to initiate. The Shiva's goes out, slowing down a lot of these heroes. The block out there with the nicely placed kinetic field. It's going to be a good enough QO. With his Mask of Mana, he needs to be able to make a leap away. Jumps further down and makes another jump to the Disruptor. And another jump, though. It's still, I don't think, going to be enough. He gets hit by the dust. They can see him. Golem, oh, what a beautiful kinetic field, actually. And now the double Golem's come into play where Sunbee, he's going to lose that Aegis. Yojung may be up next, though. He's getting a bit low. Adam is actually going to be the focus of the Golems. They turn around, start fighting up Sunbee. And Riki, not a happy camper, starts turning around. He's going to be able to kill up the Razor, as well as it looks like the rest of the team was able to finish up that Viper. It was doomed up, so a great team fight for the side of MVP as Lodom overextend themselves and mainly just get caught in that beautiful kinetic field. Which led into a nice Warlock Golem drop as well. Can't believe that Riki survived, though. That was super close. BKB for the Riki. Finally, he's going to have some extra defense. Before, it was his Mask of Madness usages just left him so exposed. But now with the BKB, it doesn't matter to him. He'll just run at these supports, and there's nothing that the enemy team can do about it.
You were my target all along.
And this regen kicking into play. Look at that. He's at 9 health per second. And with the extra bit of Mask of Madness as well, you guys can hear. Ferev just casually running around with a Haste Rune. He's going to be jumping on Adam. The smoke screen will slow him down quite significantly, but he's losing a lot of his damage on the side of QO. Tries to make a jump away, but will be caught by the Venom. That's why he turns and fights, does whatever damage he can. Unfortunately, Heen is also going to be dying here. Crimson Guard or no. At least they catch out the Lifestealer in response to that one, but I'm not sure why they're not backing up. Is this a newsflash for them that there were a lot of heroes from the side of Lodom in the middle lane making their way over? Because I don't think it should have. They lose at least one. Now the Viper is here. Yeah, this is going to be a disaster. They're just going to be kited around. I don't even know what to say to that. Like, did that catch them by surprise? The Riki and Undying just died here. And after they killed the Lifestealer, it should have been an expected, whoop, let's get the hell out of here. But instead, they went forward, and all of a sudden, it's like, oh, hey, the rest of the enemy team is here. Surprise. This bit of miscommunication from MVP. Possibly, maybe they thought the Golems were back up from the side of the Warlock or something like that. He does have double Golems now with the Refresher. So that's a pretty big upgrade. over 10,000 experience lead for MVP, though that dropped rather heavily after that team fight. And just a 15,000 gold lead where they were about 18,000. Still, MVP very much ahead, and I doubt they're going to lose too much control of this game. It's going to take a lot more bad fights like that before Lottom have a chance. So you're saying there's a chance. Sunbee, the Basher. Oh, boy. That Basher. Once he has an Abyssal, Riki guarantee, like, he goes on somebody, that's a guaranteed kill on that person. Disruptor. I wonder if that's a Yule Scepter for that Void Stone that he has. Because a Yule Scepter is actually not bad for both himself defensively as well as offensively against this enemy team. Smoke up. Smoke's going to be running into each other, and it's going to be Dubu who managed to get the Hex first at the same time. Farther up, we have the double golems being dropped on our Razor, who's trying to steal all the damage away from the Riki and turn it onto March. We'll be able to get that one kill. The golems are still very much alive, though. QO jumps farther down, is going to go for the Venomancer. It's currently being slowed down by the zombies. Looks like Sunbee will be able to kill the rest of the golems. QO, though, at least gets the kill on the Shadow Shaman, now trying to jump away, but unable to make the distance. Nice blink in with the Static Storm, but unfortunately, that looks nice. It looks pretty that he got that kinetic field static storm combination. But everybody else was dead, plus the fact that he caught the two tankiest heroes in the game. The Razor and the Viper. And that's bad team fight number two there for the side of MVP. And more ground gonna be gained by this Korean B team. Tier 2 tower going to be taken down by Lottom here. Presuming they'll be able to stick this one out for the 20 seconds that the Riki is down. Especially with the Eye of Storm Aghanim's upgrade.
Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
And Veil of Discord as well for the Venomancer. This is actually going to be pretty significant as BKB timings are beginning to drop down here. Shiva's Heen, oh boy. Crimson Guard might just be able to save him there, but Ferev is still going to have some issues being kited around. As that tombstone, there it goes. Upheaval being laid down by March, but they have no golems. QO comes in, quickly wipes out Sunbee, and Yojung's going to be up next. They even stop Ian from being able to teleport away. Nicely played. Didn't think they had him in, had it in them for that team fight, but looks like it turned out okay as QO comes in, just completely tears apart Lottom.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
And soon to be an Abyssal. Huh? What's his BKB timing down to? 8 seconds? Can't believe we don't have a BKB on the Doom. That just feels so weird.
Is under attack.
Blade Mail for the Undying, I guess? Still no mech on this team. And it is going to be Yule Scepter for the Disruptor. So I like that pickup quite
Radiant's
a bit.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's middle tower is under
attack. All right, Lottom. They're going to have to use a defensive set of wards here. And they still desperately need their Razor to be up as well. I don't think they can take a fight without him. So just trying to slow down the MVP team as much as possible. Lose their tier 3 tower. Just spamming out the
Dire's middle tower has fallen.
The Viper ultimate. And it looks like the MVP team will actually be backing themselves up. Heen, you need to be careful there. They're dealing with a team that could potentially jump him when he's that far out. And it's very obvious they don't want to actually take this fight. At least not yet, anyway. And And the last bit of gold for the old scepter is coming in for the disruptor, though I think I would have rather have liked to seen a Aghanim's upgrade. So you can at least catch out the Razor and disable his BKB inside the kinetic field and static storm combination. I would have liked to see that, but it's also not necessary, I think, this game. Sunbee, I wonder what he's going for, because BKB is a pretty absurd item on a Lifestealer. Like, it's the item rate for BKB has got to be so low, but specifically up against the Disruptor, sometimes it's necessary, because every single time that Static Storm is being used to catch him out and him alone. Or if he's just going for, like, a Halberd sort of build and getting something that would be able to deal with QL. I think I'd much prefer to see a Halberd, but we'll see that where that Ogre Club takes him. Roshan is back up if MVP want to try and take that one, but looks like they'd rather use the double golems. Not even maxed out upheaval by level 16. For shame, March. For shame, man. The ability's so good. Why are you neglecting it? Abyssal has been finished by the Riki. He's, goddamn, this guy's dangerous now. Offensively, he can still easily be focused down in team fights, but.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
There, he's gonna wipe out probably one or two heroes before that happens, especially with the relatively long duration of his BKB right now.
Dire's top tower.
And the five different charges of Blink Strike he's got ready to go.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
This regen that he gets is so absurd. Adam, he may feel confident because he's a big tanky Viper, but I'm telling you, man, this Riki does not care. Riki will gobble up any hero 1v1 right now. $3,500 gold on the Warlock. He can build into a Scythe of Ice or a Shiva's if he wants to. Reason will maybe actually catch out Sunbee there. Yeah, that's the issue. Yule Scepter being used on the Lifestealer means he drops back down directly into the silence. He has no chance to range at all.
Double damage.
And now a double damage on MVP. Well, I think they found what they're going to need to be able to successfully push uphill.
Aegis.
An Aegis for the Riki. That solves his defense problems.
Roshan has fallen to the Radiant.
I'm going to have to try out this Riki build in a pub. It's the only way. All right, the final death push coming in 35 minutes in. It's 44-25. MVP are holding on to over a 15,000 gold lead and a 10,000 experience lead. They could have been holding on to more, but they had a couple of bad team fights that gave a lot of room for Lottum. But due to just some general control of the map and things like Roshan and small pickoffs here and there, MVP have been able to grow their leads back to where it once was, and now the initiation. Sunbee tries to go in, instantly gets caught out by QO. Jump away, now the turnaround, he's going to go straight for the Razor. With the Abyssal, is going to be able to lock him down a little bit better. Now the ultimate's being dropped, Warlock Golems blows up the Venomancer, and now almost taking down the Razor as well, where a jump in, not quite enough. It looks like instead the Riki's going to be focusing on the Viper, trying to lock him down. The Doom being placed on the Razor, looks like he will tick out. At the same time, Razor goes down. And yep, there goes Sunbee. He's going to be dying a second time here. As the offlane Lifestealer, I'm thinking, didn't work out so well for them. And Mid-Rax will be falling, and that'll be the double golems, probably leading into the top Rax. Hell, they can even just go straight for the tier 4s if they want to. And this should be at least a double Raxing. So well played by QO. I mean, it feels like a bit of a trolley build, but it seemed to work out. His massive amounts of aggression. He died multiple times due to that aggression, but he still picked up plenty of kills at the same time and made a lot of space for his teammates. So he did very well as Riki. Interesting build. We'll see if Riki's actually really viable. I don't think this game really put him to the test in any way. Now the tier 4s, a lot of them are going to be left with one last desperate team fight. They've got two racks down, they've lost their tier 4s, and the throne is going to be getting very low here if they don't start moving outside of the fountain here. Adam getting bashed up, the Abyssal also going down, and they can finish Adam up, and he just hardly moves anywhere. Now the jump in, QO, pretty deep in there. He's going to be able to finish off the Venomancer before losing his Aegis. Mass Dagon's being bought by March, and the GG will be called on the side of Lodum. So well played by MVP, rather easily taking down Lodum in a 2-0 victory for them. And we'll be moving on to the finals to face up against the winner of our next best of three matchup. That is going to be Rave versus Poker Face. So looking forward to that. That's going to be starting here in another 52 minutes. We are going to be trying to start it earlier if possible, but for now, expect the game not to be starting for a full hour. So, thanks for tuning in, guys. We'll see you guys after a bit of a break. And don't forget, we also have the IZO Cup later on this evening.